Welcome in the name of Jesus this day to Zion Lutheran Church as we commemorate the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. We give God thanks for your presence here this day. We are especially honored and blessed by our guests and visitors that are here with us this day. Please know that we welcome you with warm and open arms in the name of Jesus. Today we are gathering to hear Bach's great cantata, Ein Fieste Burg, a mighty fortress is our God. And so we are thankful for our musicians and our choir, as well as Father Ken Hannon, who is our guest preacher from Oblaten Seminary over at 410 and Blanco Road. And so I hope that after today's liturgy that you'll have an opportunity to greet Father Hannon and welcome him here as well to Zion. I invite the assembly to stand, please.
Stay with us, Lord, for it is evening, and ascend before you, O Lord. And let your loving kindness descend upon us, that with purified minds we may sing your praises with the church on earth and the whole heavenly host, and may glorify you forever and ever.
Amen.
God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
Thank you.
And all the members of the body, though many, are one body. So it is with Christ. For one in the Spirit, we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot were to say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less part of the body. And if the ear would say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If we were all a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again to the head, to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And those members of the body that we think are less honorable, we clothe with greater honor. And our less respectable members are treated with greater respect, whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior members, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from John. Jesus said, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me and bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. If you have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you, abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them, bear much fruit. Because apart from me, you can do nothing. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Dear friends, allow me please to begin with a word of thanks. I am so honored and humbled to have been invited by your pastors to be with you to rejoice on this solemn day, concluding the whole year's observance of the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. Like you, my reasons for this joy are spiritual and biblical and theological, and they are also deeply personal. The most admirable person in my childhood world was my grandfather, a lifelong member of St. John's Lutheran Church downtown. I learned practical Christianity from him while he taught me how to hammer nails and eat jalapeno peppers. How could I be other than hugely joyful that we can worship together as we do now in this blessed time? The texts we've heard proclaimed offer two complex images of unity in diversity, one addressed to the largely Gentile community of Corinth, and the other addressed to largely excommunicated Jewish Christians, probably at Ephesus, a mixing bowl itself of Jewish, Christian, and various Hellenistic peoples and religious traditions. In both cases, the inspired word emerges from within division and insists on union. What could be a better starting place for our reflection today? Our communities have known deep and often painful and even violent division. However, at this distance of 500 years, perhaps we're more able to sympathize with the protagonists and to credit their sincerity and devotion, even if we cannot hold all that they held exactly as they held it. In this, we are the beneficiaries of several convergences which have bridged some of the gaps. By employing scholars and pastors and faithful in common critical research and reflection on the Word of God and the world that produced our sacred texts. Convergent also has been the shared discovery and reflection on the origins of Christian worship, as we see in this liturgy today, which you celebrate according to your Lutheran worship hymnal. Especially during the last 50 years, we have been blessed to stand witness to historic convergence even of doctrine, drawing us closer and closer together. And all of this we can affirm as God-given grace, incarnate in our history and in our times, drawing us from conflict to communion. Having denounced the divisions among the Corinthian converts as being so deep as to compromise their worship, St. Paul turns to an explanation of the quite opposite movement of the Spirit in distributing gifts for the building up of the community. That leads to his startling assertion that those who are reborn through that same Spirit in baptism can be likened to a single body, indeed, the body of Christ. Any Corinthian who thought they could go it alone would surely be disabused by Paul's intricate examination of the utter interdependence of the members. It's a matter of life and death, after all. Perhaps I'm not alone in being grateful that he took the time and the care to make room for those weaker, unpresentable, or inferior parts. No part lives without the totality, nor the body lives without all of its parts. That message must have been very consoling to those who felt they had been overlooked when the Spirit endowed others with remarkable gifts. I too have known something of that feeling. It is worth noting, though, that the body, like any body, is not meant simply to be, as in repose. Not at all. The gifts have been given for the sake of the body's participation in the Spirit-led mission that continues the work of its Savior. This is the vocation of each and all who are baptized in Christ. We too are sent on mission. Our worship itself stands in stark contrast to the disunity which still inhibits our witness in spite of our progress in deepening respect, love, and grace. The Spirit makes us impatient, and we can be grateful for that too. The passage we have read from the fourth gospel invites reflection on unity and diversity, but from a different angle. In his farewell discourse after the betrayer has left, Jesus portrays his permanent relation with his disciples in the image of the vine and the branches. He is and always will be the sharing source of life and fruitfulness among them and among us. Abiding together in him is the unique gift he offers to those who belong to him. But that gift also has its dynamic dimension. Only in his abiding love can his followers be abundantly fruitful. But that fruitfulness expresses itself in evangelization and witness and communion for the sake of the whole world's salvation. There is an awful mystery here. Behold the breathtaking wonder that the Savior should entrust to us the ongoing fulfillment of his mission. How could we bear such a responsibility? Only, but really, because he abides in us in love and we in him. This overwhelming mercy and trust leaves us speechless in gratitude, for all is gift. That gratitude draws us together and enables us to transcend differences and celebrate what unites us already as it urges us onward on our journey together. Let no one mistake us. We journey to commune. The Spirit makes us impatient for that communion which alone fulfills the Lord's command that we be one, united in Him and in His love. The communion God intends is itself a mystery. Thus, in imitation of our Savior, of His mother, and His first disciples, we too commit to the will of the Father, whose accomplishment is as yet not disclosed to us. In that fidelity, we can paraphrase the legendary profession of Martin Luther, and we can say, Hier stehen wir. Wir können auch nicht anders. Here we stand. We also cannot do otherwise. God bless us all.
Thank you. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. But in these last days, God has spoken to us by the
and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray.
peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord. For those who work to bring peace, justice, healing, and protection in this and every place, let us pray to the Lord. For those who travel, for those who are sick and suffering, and for those who are in captivity, let us pray to the Lord. Danger and need, let us pray to the Lord. For all servants of the church, for this assembly, and for all people who await from the Lord great and abundant mercy, let us pray to the Lord. Giving thanks for all who have gone before us and are at rest, rejoicing in the whole communion of saints, we commend ourselves, one another, and our whole life to you, through Christ our Lord. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.